just lazy. I'm gonna sit gazing to the end I leave. When I die to every night, why should I shake my face? Because my dynamite changed your mind about me. Dinah, if you wanna do China, I'm gonna have a little smile. Tell the baby that I leave.
Oh, it was beautiful. It was wonderful. We had a lot of fun doing it. Because you would sing the song, and then all of a sudden you'd see a movie come out. The picture would come out. There would be cartoons of maybe frogs or something like that. There was no publicity of pictures or anything like that. Only after we started traveling around the country did they know that we were black. And as far as any problems or anything like that, we've never had any problems because we would never work any place where only people couldn't come to. It was April of 1934, and we were working at the Palladium Theater in London. And we were asked to do a command performance for King George and Queen Mary. And it was a wonderful, wonderful thing because being on stage and looking out at the audience, all this great big theater with everybody in tails and white evening gowns, and the most amazing thing about it was looking up at the box of the King and Queen, and not far from where they were, my mother was sitting up in the box, and that was the most beautiful thing I've ever seen in my life.
My oldest brother, John.
I always had a tremendous admiration for him because he taught me everything I ever knew. And I can always see him today with a ukulele in his hand. And he inspired me all the way.
He took sick in Paris. We flew back to London, then back to the United States. But he was sick quite a long time in England. My brother and I stayed over there. Harry came back with our mother. We stayed over and brought him back to the United States. And later on, he had to go back into the hospital. He had pneumonia. And then we went back to England again in 1935, latter part of 1935. And I think actually what happened, he started back to work too soon. He took sick again in England. So we brought him back, and he passed away in January of 1936.
Right to this day, as far as all of my brothers are concerned, I try to follow in his footsteps right to this day. I always think that I can do more for my other two brothers today than any of us.
And that at that time, we decided, well, maybe it's about time we gave up, you know?
And her mother took us in the room and set us down and said, look, your brother wouldn't like that. So we continued going on. Then we started looking for a bass singer because my brother sang bass and played guitar. And we interviewed, I imagine, about 15 or 16 different people. And none of them seemed to fit. So one day, my father walked in while we were rehearsing. And he said, everybody out, I'm taking over. And that's when he joined us.
John Sr. was a very quiet, real gentleman, very quiet. Generally, he would speak when he was spoken to, and very,
Very bright, very nice.
And at that time, we were looking for a guitar player. And a fellow by the name of Freddie Green, who was with Count Basie Band, sent Norman Brown down to here to have an interview with us. And the only thing we asked him to do was play the introduction of the theme song. He played it so well, he said, well, you got the job. And he started with us at the same time.
My father did. We stayed in England in 1936 when we went back. We were over there for about 8 months, traveling all over Europe. By the time we come back, most people had gotten into a group called the Ink Spots, and they came up with a record called If I Didn't Care, 1937, I think it was. And they became a very, very popular group in the United States.
I met the Mills Brothers in either late 1941 or early 1942. They were working the Florentine Gardens on Hollywood Boulevard in Hollywood, California.
But, of course, they needed to reestablish themselves throughout the United States.
Most of the people had practically forgot about the Mills Brothers. And we picked up a tune that became a very big song for us, a thing called Paper Doll, recorded in 1941.
I'm gonna buy a paper doll that I can call my own, a doll that other fellows cannot see. And then the flirty, flirty guys with their flirty, flirty eyes will have to flirt with dollies that are real. When I come home at night, she will be waiting. She'll be the truest doll in all this world. I'd rather have a paper doll to call my own than have a fickle-minded real-life girl.
When we first heard the song, we didn't particularly care for it because the way it was written, it wasn't too much to our liking, but we sat down and we worked on it, and we got a different idea of the conception of the song, and that's when we changed it, and we went in to record it.
She's gone away and left you, just like all dogs do. I guess you know it's tough to be alone, and it's tough to love a doll that's not your own. I'm through with the loving, I'll never fall again. Say, boy, what you gonna do? I'm going to buy a paper doll that I can call my own, a doll that other fellows cannot steal. And then the flirty, flirty guys with their flirty, flirty eyes we'll have to flirt with dollies that are real. When I come home at night, she will be waiting. She'll be the truest doll in all this world.
have a paper doll to call my own.
Then have a fickle-minded real girl.
I would say it was more than the turning point. The other side of the song was this thing called I'll Be Around. And then somebody decided to turn it over.
I'll Be Around sold a million copies
within 13 weeks. Then the radio disc jockeys decided to turn the record over and Paper Doll just took off.
Children, my darling, please
sessions they had. Many times they'd go in to record certain songs and someone, a song plugger would come in with a song or somebody would show up with a song and they would learn it and record it and on occasions those songs became hits. A song that was flashed in front of them at the last moment in the studio.
And at that time there was no way you could splice anything. You had to go in and do it right. They used to call us one take Millsies. Because we'd go in and rehearse the song, and we put it on wax. And it was just one take.
It wasn't like today's recording where it takes 6 or 8 months to get an album out. They could get an album out in a week.
You
Herbert, he would never do a solo. He always wanted to sing the harmony parts. So one day we were on stage. Harry and I just decided to walk away from the microphone. Left him standing and he had to stand. And that's the only reason why he does a solo today.
Thank you.
Things were different then than they are today with records and establishing locations to play and so forth. There were lots of problems, naturally, during the war with traveling and being able to work in various locations and various cities. And it took a little, it was a little more strenuous, a little more difficult than it would be normally. And they played theaters. Vaudeville was the popular thing with a name band, a swing band, or a popular band of the day, and added acts, dancers as opening acts.
If we figured the price was too high and the guy wouldn't make any money, then we would make concessions for that so that nobody lost anything. And I think that is one of the reasons why we have stayed in the business so many years, by not overpricing ourselves. But at the same time, every year, year after year, the money increased. And then my father worked with us for about 23 years. Then he retired. It wasn't a question of not wanting to tour. He just got tired of traveling. And he decided, well, that's about time I retired. So he did. At the time he retired, he was, I think, 75. And then we went on as a trio.
We have definitely been very well satisfied with the great capabilities of Mr. Norman Brown. Also, our father joined us in 1936 singing the bass, and that made five in the group. Our father has since retired about 12 years ago. He's doing a lot of hunting and fishing, things like we'd like to do, sitting on his money belt and so on and so forth. Here's a little novelty you might remember called the glowworm. Never leave us, lest you fall. Give under love, sweet voices calling yonder.